we miss you.
Hi, everybody. This is your reminder that no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter what you're thinking or feeling, you're welcome here with us. We're glad you're here. We'll hold you in the chaos. We'll love you in the joy. We'll simply be in one another's presence. This isn't a place where we're ashamed of who we are. It's a place where we're open about who we are. We love you. We're glad you're here. Please join me in our centering thought for the day. In matters of truth and justice, there is no difference between large and small problems, for issues concerning the treatment of people are all the same.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us we pray, unfailing world remain. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come and lead us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives. For your joy and prize, to see the captive hearts release, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We will give our lives for heaven's call. We are your church. We pray, revive this land. Build your kingdom.
Question for them. I don't have a book today, but I do have some things for you guys to talk about. And what I'm wondering is, have you ever felt that something was not fair? Completely not fair. Like you didn't get any dessert and everybody else got two slices, or maybe the teacher didn't call on you and they called on your friend five times. Maybe someone else got to go swimming and you didn't. what's happened in your life that's just been not fair? I know it's hard when things aren't really fair. It's not really fun. It's hard for us to think about things not being fair. But today we're talking about justice. It's a really big word, meaning that fairness looks different for a lot of people. Sometimes when somebody gets more potatoes than you at dinner, it doesn't mean that it's not fair. It just means they're a little bit hungrier than you are. Or when someone gets to go inside on a really, really, really hot day, maybe they're just having a really hard time staying outside. Sometimes when it's fair, it doesn't mean everything's even. And that's kind of hard. That's a hard thing to learn. But an important question to ask is, what does this other person need, and how can I help them? The next time you think something's not fair, ask yourself, and ask your parents, and ask your teachers, why are they getting special treatment and I'm not? There may be something happening that's different in their life that you just don't know about yet. And it's important that we can understand everybody so the world's a happier place. It's a practice of this congregation to give generously whatever you have and whatever you can to the ministries of this church. I know that giving is a little bit challenging and kind of tricky in this time. It looks different than passing the offering plate around and adding some things to it. It's not writing a check in the pew while the music's playing. It's not dropping in change at the beginning of the worship service. But it still helps to support the ministries of the church. It helps keep worship going. It helps feed your neighbors. It helps Pastor Meredith do what needs done in the community so that your church is always working for justice. Go on and take this time to give what you can. Put the stamp on the envelope. Push send in the online version. Whatever it is you need to do to give to the ministries of this church. And if there's another way you can give, please let us know. Maybe you have a super full garden, or maybe you have some musical gifts to share. Maybe you just love writing poems. Let us know how you can give to continue to support the ministries of this church. We'll be glad to hear from you. Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Isaiah. This is Isaiah chapter 56, verses 1 through 8. Hear now the words of the prophet. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. Happy is the mortal who does this, the one who holds it fast, who keeps the Sabbath, not profaning it, and refrains from doing any evil. Do not let the foreigner joined to the Lord say, the Lord will surely separate me from his people. And do not let the church say, I am just a dry tree. For thus says the Lord to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbath, who choose the things that please me and hold fast to my covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord and to keep and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and who do not profane it, and hold fast my covenant. These I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in thy house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcast of Israel, I will gather others to them, besides those already gathered. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Do you guys remember having to recite the Pledge of Allegiance in school before class started? I don't think it's a thing that happens much anymore, but when I went to school, we had to do it all the time. We had kids in our class who used to get really embarrassed because they would say amen at the end. It was much like reciting a prayer in church. The end of the Pledge of Allegiance ended with justice for all. And when you're a kid, when you're little, when you're just memorizing some words to say, that's something really hard to understand. The older I got, the more uncomfortable I was with the Pledge of Allegiance. I knew that justice for all didn't always look like justice for all. Even at a very young age, I had a sense of what it meant to feed people who were hungrier than I was, even when I was hungry. I understood that some of my classmates needed to sleep in class instead of being awake for the math lesson because they didn't get to sleep at home. I knew what it meant to go to school and to have clothes that were better than others. At times I was told to be grateful for what I had because not everyone had what I had. My response wasn't okay or to give thanks for my blessings. It was to ask how I could do something to help those in my community who didn't have what I have. I understood from a very young age that our community was only as strong as those who had the least. That our community breathed in and breathed out with the impoverished. That our community breathed in and breathed out with those who struggled with addiction or depression or anxiety. That our community breathed in and breathed out with the hungry and the poor. And we lived in a very small town. Not many people would come and go, much like happened in Scripture. But even from a young age, I understood that community breathed in and breathed out, and that measure of how deeply they could breathe in was in how they treated the stranger. My community was small. There was a lot that we did to help one another, but there's also a lot that we did to isolate one another. When we said the Pledge of Allegiance and we spoke about justice for all, it was never easy and it never made sense. What does justice look like? Justice is one of those hard words. Gets you a lot of points in Scrabble. But what does justice really mean? We've been seeing a lot about justice recently. Lots of protests that have signs. They want justice for those who have been killed at the hands of police. They want justice for those who are no longer breathing. Justice for those who can't speak for themselves. Justice in our world today looks like demanding swift and appropriate punishment for those who have done unspeakable wrongdoings. Justice, just like I shared with the kids, is understanding that fair isn't fair, is understanding that just because you have privilege, you shouldn't also have permission to treat others the way you wouldn't want to be treated. Our opening thought was from Albert Einstein. Every issue of justice is an important issue of justice. Big problems, small problems, they're all the same because they all concern the people of God. What does justice look like? What does justice look like for us in the church? What does justice look like for us in the community? How do we breathe in and breathe out with those who are least among us? And the scripture for this morning comes from the book of Isaiah. He's a prophet, one of the major prophets, we call him. He has a lot to say. There's a lot of pages that Isaiah uses to talk about what is to come. That's the thing about prophets. Like we talked about last week, prophets are not ones who are silent on things that matter. Prophets are always tasked with speaking justice. They're tasked with naming what is wrong in community and with telling the community how to do right, with telling the community how to repent, how to make the world a better place for those who are least among them. Isaiah, this morning, he speaks of universal salvation. What Isaiah talks about is a restoration, something that's going to come and be better than anything else before. The eunuchs and the foreigners, they're going to be welcome into the fold, just like everybody else. They're not going to be on the outside anymore. For Isaiah, justice looks like the woman at the well doesn't have to go in the hottest part of the day because she's welcomed in the community and she can go with everyone else. It's important to Isaiah that we remember who we are, that we remember the Sabbath, that we remember everyone as an equal member of community, as a beloved member of community, that we ask, what's not fair? And what can I do to make it right? You may remember just before Easter on Passover when Jesus gets mad, flips over the tables in the temple. We call this the cleansing of the temple. Jesus says, my house has become a den of robbers when it's meant to be a house of prayer for all people. This comes from Isaiah. Why are you here in the temple selling sacrifices at an ungodly price just so people can worship my Father? Why are you robbing my people? This isn't justice. Jesus turns over the tables to make a point. He also turns over the tables to show justice. Those who are there, to show those who are spending more than they can afford that it doesn't have to be that way. That restoration can look like spending what you can in an appropriate amount to offer your sacrifice at the temple. Anything you can give, no matter how small. That's what's fair. That's what delights God. That's what Isaiah is talking about. What is it that we do as a community to bring everyone in? Today, justice looks like a lot more than just tipping over the tables at the temple. Justice in this past couple of months has looked like nightly protests to demand justice for people who still haven't been arrested for murdering others in cold blood. Justice looks like demanding that privilege be put aside. It looks like speaking for those who have no voice to help the community grow through the pain, to ensure that there are better systems in place, to help the community to understand what it looks like when unemployment can't be attained, to understand what community can do to support those who are struggling deeply for a place in the community, those who are home jobless now. Justice looks like finding ways to be with them in the struggle, in the silence, in the uncertainty. Justice brings everyone together. Justice isn't discriminate. Justice tells us with much to step into the world, to assist with those who have little, to bring them to the well with us at the end of the day, to help share the good news with them that salvation is coming. Indeed, salvation is here. They're not in a different class than us. We're all here. We're helping to speak for those who have no voice. What does justice for all mean? It's complicated. That's the short answer. But the good news is that we don't have to decide what justice looks like all on our own. In this space, we have one another to learn from and to learn with and alongside. To say, what does justice look like? To name the places where we have failed. To repent for those places where we have failed. And to look forward with hope to something new that is to come. To something that moves us from hopelessness to hopefulness. To help the community to breathe in and breathe out deeper than they ever have before. Because we're working together. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. To the world to do justice. That's our job as Christians. It's what we're called to do. We're called to act with justice, to speak for those who can't speak for themselves, to amplify the voices of those that don't get heard. Go do justice. It's not easy, but it's what's right. May God the Father, Christ the Son, and the community of the Holy Spirit be ever with you in this holy work. Amen.